Hello, my name is Mark. I'm from TDT. As you may know, we make hardware and software systems for neurophysiology research. In part 1 of this video, I'm going to introduce Lab Rat, our amazing entry-level system you can use to do real experiments. Lab Rat works with Corpus, our DSP emulation technology, and is fully supported by Synapse, our powerful recording software. Together, these amazing technologies deliver a complete and capable system for doing neurophysiology experiments. In this video, I'll give you a quick tutorial to get you started on using the system. Let's start by reviewing what comes in the box. If you're watching this video, it's likely you've already found the software USB drive. If you have not already done so, install the Synapse Lite software from this drive. Also in the box is the Lab Rat interface. It is the core device in the system. All neural signals and other lab I/O will be connected through this device. This kit includes a 16-channel active head stage for recording from high impedance electrodes and a simple breakout adapter for surface electrodes with touch-proof connectors. Now remove the Lab Rat interface to reveal the USB Type-C cable and Type-A adapter. Also stored in this area are some disposable surface electrodes that we will be using in this demonstration. Let's take a closer look at the Lab Rat interface. Here is the USB Type-C connector. Use the provided cable and adapter if needed to connect the Lab Rat to your computer. It's important to connect the Lab Rat to a USB 3 port on your computer. If you're unsure about what type of port your computer has, check with the manufacturer's documentation. Next, there is a standard DB25 port for connecting to the digital and analog I/O. Two of the digital bits are also made available here on these BNCs. And the analog I/O channels are repeated here on these headphone jacks. This knob adjusts the level of the internal speaker, which plays the first DAC channel. This 12-pin Omnetics connector supports intan-based digital head stages, like TDT's ZED32 ZIF clip device. Finally, connect your analog neural signals to this DB26. This 16-channel input offers high-fidelity recording for just about any neural signal. This is the device status indicator. It illuminates green whenever Lab Rat is properly communicating with your computer. It will blink green when the device is acquiring data. If it blinks red, you have a problem. Refer to the Lab Rat documentation if you see a blinking red indication. At this point, you should have installed the Synapse Lite software on your computer. And two new icons should now be on your desktop, including the Synapse Lite icon. Also, your Lab Rat interface should be connected to your computer through a USB 3 port. Now, double-click the Synlite icon to run the program. And notice that when you run Synapse, a program called Corpus is automatically launched. Corpus is a specialized program that will emulate TDT's DSP devices using your computer's processor. I encourage you to watch my informational video on the Corpus emulator. Corpus is also the program that communicates with the Lab Rat device. Drag here to see the Lab Rat device connected to the emulated RZ2 DSP processor. Appreciating that Lab Rat connects to Synapse through Corpus is important to understanding how signals are accessed from the Synapse software. Corpus gives Lab Rat connection status using this icon. A green indication means your Lab Rat device is properly connected using USB 3. If this indicator turns red, your device is connected using the USB 2 protocol. We do not recommend using Lab Rat with USB 2. Whenever Synapse Lite is running, Corpus will also run. And when you close Synapse, Corpus will automatically follow. Slogging through these details is getting boring, even for me. So let's switch gears and do something fun. There's nothing better than a hands-on demonstration. So let's do a real experiment using your new lab rat system. In this experiment, we are going to record electrical signals from the muscles in your forearm. Your lab rat kit comes with a set of disposable electrodes and an alcohol wipe to prep the skin. Collecting these signals is pretty easy. You'll want to place the electrodes about like this. The exact location is not crucial, however, preparing the skin before placing the electrodes is important to getting good clean muscle signals. Using the alcohol pad, scrub the skin aggressively where you intend to place the electrodes. Rub until the skin is red, to remove oils and the dry, top layer of skin. Now, stick the electrodes on like this. Red and black will be our signal and reference. The green is our ground. Connect the electrodes into the SP4 like this, and connect the SP4 to the lab rat's neural input. Note, the red and black wires go to channels 1 and 2 of the SP4. This is because we will be running the amplifier in differential mode, also called individual referencing. In this mode, odd and even channel pairs act as the non-inverting and inverting inputs, while the shared reference input is ignored. Once you have the electrodes in place and properly connected to the lab rat, run the Synapse Lite software by double-clicking the icon. In this demonstration, I'm not going to give an in-depth introduction to Synapse and its many features. There are other videos on our website that offer a full introduction to this powerful software. Instead, I'll show you how to click a few buttons, record some data, and build an experiment. First, let's set up the lab rat amplifier so we can collect our EMG signals. Click on it in the processing tree to show its setup dialog. Now we'll adjust a few settings. We need just one channel. Also click the impedance monitor on so we can check how well we did with the electrode application. Then select EMG from this list, and the lab rat amplifier will be configured with appropriate settings for EMG signals. Click the commit button to apply these changes. In Synapse, we add functionality to an experiment by adding gizmos to the processing tree. Let's add a gizmo from the neural category to filter and save our EMG signal. Drag and drop the neural stream processor gizmo on the lab rat icon in the processing tree. In its options dialog, select the EMG radio button and proper settings for filtering and data saving will be selected automatically. Because power mains can corrupt our signal, I like to turn on notch filtering for 60 Hz and its harmonics. Also, click the runtime control on so we can adjust these filter settings while we're collecting data. Click commit to apply these changes, and we're ready to record. Click the preview button to switch Synapse into runtime mode. This trace shows our EMG signal. Hold the shift key and drag the mouse upward to zoom the plot so we can see our signal. Relax your arm and rest it on the tabletop. Then clench your fist or wiggle your fingers to create bursts of activity. Later we'll need to detect these bursts as part of our experiment. So practice resting and bursting. It's important that you're not holding your arm in the air. This will cause elevated background activity and make it difficult to detect the burst onset. Now, I'll arrange the screen layout so I can adjust the filtering while viewing the active trace. Try flipping the notch filters into bypassed, and you'll see how much mains corruption you're getting. As you can see, without these filters, my signal would be unusable, so I'll leave them clicked on. Mains corruption is made worse by elevated electrode impedance. Click the LR10 tab and the impedance check button, and let's see how we did with our electrode preparation. I'm showing 35 kilo ohms. This is not very good, You should work for impedances of less than 10 kiloohms, to get better recordings and less mains corruption. No worries, we can make this work. I'm still getting well-defined resting and bursting periods, that will be easy to detect. Let's tweak the plot scaling a bit more. Notice the signal voltages we're seeing. I'm going to drop the low-pass filter a bit, to clean up some of the high-frequency noise. You'll see now, that my resting trace, is very clean. The bursts, while somewhat diminished, are clearly visible. Adjust the plot scaling one more time, and note that the voltage for detecting a burst, will be somewhere around 50 microvolts. We'll need this information shortly, as we set up our burst detector. Now, click the idle button, to flip back into edit mode, so we can add some functionality to our experiment. This is a good time to take a break. We have covered a lot, and there is much more to come. Click here, on your desktop to find part 2 of this introduction video. Bye for now, hope to see you soon.